Mindset around what it is that we're going to focus on. A lot of people get really caught up in the products of Youngevity. I hear your conversations, I hang out with you, I hear how you talk to other people and what you choose to focus on, and there's a reason why people make money, and there's a reason why people don't make money in network marketing. If you don't want to make money in network marketing, then keep talking about the products. Did you hear what I said?
Yeah.
How many of you are upset? How many of you got just upset right now? Okay, good. Nobody? That's good. If you don't want to make money in Youngevity, then keep talking about the products. Some of you are going, what? What's he talking about? This whole company is built on Dr. Wolf. Yeah, I know. I got that. So, how many people do you think have cancer?
No.
What's the percentage?
Most people take 3.
1 in 3 people you think have cancer? Here? Okay, that's pretty high.
Yeah,
how many people do you think have diabetes?
1 in 4.
1 in 4? How many people do you think have heart disease?
1 in 3.
1 in 3?
Okay.
Is
it a certain age group
you
would
think,
or is it
in
general?
Nope, just in general. I'm going somewhere with these questions. How many people do you think are broke?
A lot.
A lot.
So why don't you rescue people with vitamin M? Money. You guys talk about everything else that's on a lesser scale. What do you have to have in order to take care of yourself with your health? You have to have money. You have to have a lot of money. Don't kid yourself. You need a lot of money to live in this world. You need a lot of money to take care of your health. So, give me some thoughts. Why do people so quickly throw out that they've got great products to handle cancer and diabetes and heart disease? Why don't you throw out the product of vitamin M to people? Why don't people do that?
They're not comfortable talking about money.
Why? You're comfortable talking about cancer. You're comfortable talking about diabetes.
I wonder if it's because success in our society is rated according to your income level, and so people don't like to talk about it because they don't like to be perceived as not successful. That's what I've always wondered.
That's an interesting thought.
That's New Zealand.
I make money. So that doesn't apply to me.
There's somebody else controlling your money. How
Sorry?
Much you get. Someone else controlling you, how much you're going to get when you go to work.
Yes. Yeah. So, what's your name again?
Marion.
Marion? Marion. Okay. So, Marion, I'm going to role play with you right now. You're new as of yesterday, correct?
Yeah.
Okay. So, literally, how well do we know each other right now?
1 hour, 2 hours.
Okay. Yep. And are you able to judge me on any level? Did you make any judgments
yes,
about me?
Straight away.
What do you know?
Got no hair.
And does that allow you to make any conclusions about how I might be able to impact your life because I have no hair? Could you conclude anything about my impact on your life by having no hair?
No, because my son got no hair too.
Like that. Okay, so no harm, no foul on me not having hair, correct? All right. Can you make any other judgments about me?
The way you dress.
Okay, and what does that say?
You're a business person.
And what does that say?
You're wealthy.
Okay, good. And there's a time and a place to show that, right?
Yeah.
Yesterday I spent all day in sweatpants, tennis shoes, and a t-shirt. So yesterday you might have said I was irresponsible.
Yes.
Right? Could have come to that conclusion. Right. same time that I looked like a slob yesterday,
I also
recruited somebody yesterday. I don't even live here. I don't even sound like I fit in. I'm a stranger. Isn't that an excuse that a lot of people make in life? I don't fit in, I'm a stranger. And people make false judgments about me. So I listened to 6 or 7 people at a table last night talking with a person that was working at this restaurant that we were at. And when they were done talking, I started talking. And in that moment, everyone that was sitting at that table recognized that they could be doing something different to get a different outcome with their business. Right, Cliff?
Yes.
What'd you notice?
You asked a specific question, not just an individual.
Yep, they were probing questions, weren't they?
Right.
They were probing questions. I asked probing questions. She wasn't even thinking about what I was wearing anymore. She wasn't thinking about what my hair looked like. She wasn't thinking about my accent. You guys have the accents. I don't know what you guys are talking about. She wasn't thinking about my accent. She was thinking about herself. Because I got her talking about herself. And I was so focused on serving her and helping her fulfill her goals and objectives and live her dream. In that moment, she vocalized something back to me. She said that I was a great question asker. And she asked me why I was concerned about her. And she asked me if I was for real. And that kind of how it went, guys? Yep. And someone else asked her for her number. She didn't give it out. And I asked her for her number, and she gave it to me. In the same conversation. So, why do you think that is?
Trust.
I wasn't selling her anything. And if the people that were there last night, did I ever say anything about products? Did I ever mention the name of our company? Did I ever say Dr. Wallach? Did I ever make any promises or insinuations or conversations about how much money she was going to make? Interesting. So here's your whole goal. Your whole, if you want to make money building this business, your whole goal is to engage and to be interested in them and to set an appointment to discuss what it was that you were engaging on. Just set an appointment. That's it. No speeches, no statements, nothing. Create value and set the appointment. That's all I do, is I just set appointments. I set an appointment based on something that I heard them say they wanted more of out of their life. And as soon as they tell me what it is that they want more of out of their life, then I say, you know what? I specialize in helping people do that. In the next 24 hours, what would be the best time for you and I to get together? And you have an appointment. If it helps them get what they want, do they care what it is that you're doing? It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what you're doing. All that matters is that they want something, and you're going to help them get there, and they don't care what it's called. So they don't care if it's called network marketing. They don't care if it's called direct sales. They don't care if it's an in-home business. They don't care if it's a pyramid. They don't care. It makes no difference. Why should anybody care? So, does that make sense, Mary?
Yeah.
Makes a lot of sense?
Yeah.
Excellent. Okay. How many people have struggled with the invite? You want to build a business and you struggled with the invite. Okay, is it Anita? Okay, tell me something that you have found to be difficult when it comes to inviting. Because I'm going to show you how to invite. When you leave here, you're going to be masters at inviting.
don't know how to, I can do like the whole, what their goals and their dreams are, but I don't know how to get it to, you know, like to actually ask for their phone number and make an appointment, like, or invite them to something.
Yeah. Okay, everybody write down four words on their piece of paper. White collar, I guess that's two words. Four terms. White collar, blue collar, entrepreneur, and educated. White collar, blue collar, entrepreneur, and educated. Now take a second and assess which one are you. Put a check mark next to the one that you are. White collar is defined as somebody that looks like this every day. They put on nice clothes and they go to work. Blue collar is someone that typically doesn't leverage their education and let me see, where is Jason? Jason, you're a mechanic, right? Blue collar. Okay, he's got rough hands, uses his hands, blue collar. Educated, someone that labels themselves as, I went to this school or that school and I have a degree in, and you're smart. You're really smart. You want everybody to know how smart you are. You put titles behind your name. Scott Bardulis, comma, MD, JD, CPA. Educated person. Entrepreneur, someone that's creative. A risk taker. Someone who has started their own business before. Someone who's currently running their own business. Somebody who's working with an entrepreneur and you're a partner in something. Entrepreneurial, creative. Thinker, outside the box, startup. If that's you, put a check mark next to that. So everybody got themselves figured out which one closely describes you. Okay, what's your name, sir?
Steven.
That's what I thought. And which one did you pick?
Entrepreneur.
You're entrepreneur. Okay, real briefly, tell us why you labeled yourself as an entrepreneur.
I work with 12 people who are entrepreneurs, and we basically help people businesses.
Okay, great. Congratulations, by the way.
Thanks.
That's great. How long have you been doing that?
With this group?
Sure.
Since February.
Okay.
Yep.
And how's it going?
Great.
It's going good?
Yes.
You said great. That's above good.
Yes.
And what makes it great?
Satisfaction I get out of it.
Okay.
When you see that you're actually saving a business, and the employees are still going to be here.
Are you making money?
I could make more money.
Yes. However, you're making money doing what you're doing?
Yeah.
Are you paying the bills?
Yes.
Okay. Are you still needing capital?
Yes.
Okay. So you're not doing that good.
You need to take
in more capital for your business?
Yeah, I need more capital.
Need more capital. Okay. Just seeing where you're at in that journey. All right. Now watch this. If my name is Steven, so I just took on this persona. My name is Steven now. Just a minute. Okay? I'm an entrepreneur. I've got two partners. We're helping other businesses succeed. We're giving them advice. People are coming to us. And so by now, my circle of influence knows what I do for a living, right? If you hang out with Steven, you already know that that's what he does. So here's how you're going to approach people. If your name is Steven and you're an entrepreneur, so here's your word track. I call them word tracks. Every one of you needs a word track. And you're going to memorize your word track. And there's four word tracks based on four descriptions. So you're going to memorize your word track, Steven. And when you memorize it, it's going to look something like this. And when you get it down, like I can shoot from the hip really quickly. I don't have to sit here going, okay, what does that really look like? No, I mean, I already know his word track. It goes something like this. So let's just pretend, Steven, that you are really good friends with Tracy. Okay? This is Tracy right here. We're gonna pretend like you two are friends. And on your piece of paper, you don't have to think of them right now, I want you to come up with six individuals that you can put on a piece of paper, Steven, that you can contact. Okay, I want you to think of six people that you can contact. These are people you're going to reach out to this week. All six of them. this week you're going to reach out to 6 people, and instead of what everybody else would do, because I know this is what happens in network marketing, you're told to build a list, and then you're going to go talk to those people, and it's not going to work out so well. And that's why the statistic is 1.7 people will be sponsored by a new person in network marketing before they quit. Did you hear that? Yeah. A person getting started in network marketing will sponsor 1.7 people before they quit. You know why? Because they had to talk to 10 to 15 people to get 1.7 people to say yes. That's a lot of burn through. Would you agree with that?
Yep.
Billy Ann, right? Got it. Get the names down. And it's Trejos. Tejos. Okay, get in and move it here. It's done. All right. So, you don't want to be that statistic. That's the average in the industry. Don't be that statistic. You know why people are that statistic? Because anybody can build a network marketing business. Anybody. You know, if you wanted to be a CPA, you're going to go spend a lot of money, you're going to go to school, you're going to take one of the hardest tests in the world to become a CPA. Most people fail it their first time. And then you've earned the right, when you graduate with that degree, you can go hang your shingle. Yes? You're a CPA?
What's a CPA?
How would I know? Certified public accountant. Yep, certified public accountant. People that do taxes for people. People that handle people's money, right? Their finances and put reports together. You do that? Okay. So, Stephen's a CPA. He worked hard. Like, not anybody can be a CPA. You're not going to just wake up one day and say, I'm going to be a CPA. No, you're not. Not unless you pay his price. You got to go pay that price. Time, money, lots of studying, attention to detail. That CPA test, I can tell you right now, he's probably one of the smartest guys in this room. No joke. That test is harder than the medical test, as I hear it. To be a medical doctor, that test is very complicated. There's just so much to know. So on that note, not anybody can hang their shingle. Being a medical doctor, like Derek, not an easy task. We're talking about 4 years of college, then you're going to go do 4 years of medical school, if you can even get accepted into medical school, because unlike a lot of other schools, that's a specialty school, and few people make it into the right to start studying medicine, let alone have the dream of being a medical doctor. Few people can pull that off. Then you have to go through like a residency, which is basically where you work for nothing except you're practicing as a doctor. And then sometimes you do a fellowship, which is another couple of years, which you're learning even more under apprenticeships. And then someday you get to go hang your shingle as a doctor. So if you want to be a doctor, nope, not unless you're willing to pay this price. Here's the unfortunate thing about network marketing. The unfortunate thing about network marketing is that it's the most lucrative business in the world. It has more promise and hope than any other business in the world. More people are wealthy at network marketing than any other business. At one time there was a statistic, I don't know if it remains to be exactly this true or not today, at one time 80% of all the women in the world that made over $100,000 a year were in network marketing. That's an awesome statistic, by the way. I mean, that is bad to the bone. I love that statistic. So, ladies, get after that. I mean, it is there for the taking. And what I love about that statistic is that universally, we talked about slavery and all kinds of other things, so sorry for the stereotype. Just know that typically, I'm not being sexist, I'm just talking about the way it has been so many times, is that you take a job, and you put a man against that job, and you put a woman against that job, the man will make more money for doing the same job. Everybody aware of that? Okay, so sorry, just sharing. And what I love is that network marketing levels the playing field. Women in network marketing will kick the butt of most men in network marketing. So, big time. Ladies, step up big time. So you gotta pay the price. What's unfortunate about being a network marketer is that anybody tomorrow, in the moment, can say, I'm gonna be a network marketer, And while there should be a screening process or a weeding out process, like being a CPA or being a medical doctor, there should be a screening out process, like not everybody can pull that off. Everybody can choose to be a network marketer. You can decide to be a network marketer starting right now. That's the bad news. And the bad news is you can go out and say, hey, I'm a network marketer. My name's Scott. What's your name? And they can say, well, my name is so-and-so. And you can say, great, I want to help you build a business in network marketing. And people don't know how to ask the right questions. See, if somebody were doing that to me today, I'd have a whole string of questions. First of all, I'd say today I'm unrecruitable. I'm not employable, I'm unrecruitable, I'm retired, I'm done. And thanks and no thanks. However, if you don't know any better and you're looking for a vehicle to get you faster down the road of life, you won't know what to ask. And little do you know that you're joining somebody that's never traveled the path. They never paid the price, they never went to school, they never got a degree in network marketing, they didn't get educated, and suddenly, there you and they are, and neither of you know where you're going. That's why the average person in network marketing lasts about that long, and they end up as a statistic, and they go around saying things like, yeah, one time I did something like that, it didn't work out so well. What if it would work out well for sure? What if you knew it would work out because of who you joined, because of who you locked arms with, because of the company that you selected? It's amazing to me that people will go from job to job to job, and after each job, they'll say, I'm going to go find another job, and they'll do it jubilantly. And you won't say, yeah, I did a job like that one time, and I'm not doing that anymore. It's because you don't know that there's other options, and so you feel like, I have to go find another job. See, in my mind, here's how I program. I have to build network marketing. If for any reason, which isn't going to be the case, as far as I can tell, if for any reason Youngevity didn't work out so well, I would quickly say, I'm going to go find another network marketing company. That's how I'm wired. And you'd say, I did one of those one time and it didn't work out so well, so I'm never going to do another network marketing company. To see the difference in your mindset and your thinking, my mindset is, there is no better, greater, respectable, profitable, adventurous life, lifestyle, acquisition. There's no better thing that you could ever do in your life than to be part of the right network marketing company. That's why I picked Youngevity. I'm here because everything lines up. I mean, what you don't know about me is that I've consulted in this industry for a number of years with the big boys on the block. I know what a healthy company looks like. I know for sure what a healthy network marketing company looks like. I know what all the chemistry should look like, what the makeup should look like, who the people should look like that are running companies like this, what their backgrounds need to be, what their track records need to be. I know the records financially, what they need to look like, what profit margins need to look like, the cost of goods sold with products. I know what everything needs to look like, and I've done all that research here. You don't have to. Companies used to say, hey, Scott, would you come in here? We're doing $1.1 billion a year. We'd rather be doing $2.5 billion a year. How do we get from here to here? And I'd say, that's the right question. Now let's look at the solution. And so when I saw where Youngevity was at 3.5 years ago, I said, wow, I've looked at 100 companies and said no to find Youngevity so I could say yes. And I'm not exaggerating. I've seen so many companies in this industry, and I'm not saying that all the other companies aren't good. There's some great companies out there. They're just not as great as Youngevity. They're just not as great as Youngevity. So that's why I'm here. And you don't have to wonder about all that stuff because we've already done it for you. You are, even if it's happenstance or you just luckily walk through the door, don't take it as luck. Take it as somebody else thought enough about you, which is why you're here. And you just need to be grateful and thankful to them. You don't need to look at the person that made you walk through the door as your saving grace and your entire reason for being successful. They're just the person who brought you here. We have systems, we have processes, we have training. You just need to plug into that and always be thankful to your sponsor for inviting you. That's it. They're not the reason you're going to be successful. They could help you be successful. Just in case you're going, well, I don't really have that person that's the master yet in Youngevity that invited me through the door, that's fine. You don't need them to be. You just always have to thank them for bringing you through the door. Now you're through the door. Just the principles we're teaching you right now, just apply these, and you'll be wildly successful. So Anita, back to this example right here, and I'm doing this for you because I want you to watch this. So back to Stephen. So we got on this topic because I said anybody can hang their shingle today as a network marketer. In any other career in the world, it takes time and money and painful sacrifice to get there. And here's what I'll tell you about network marketing. If you want to be successful, it's going to take time and money and painful sacrifice. The difference, life is hard. We talked about this yesterday. Life is really hard. Just choose your heart. Pick the right kind of heart. If you can work hard for 2 years and be retired in 2 years, wouldn't that be a better work hard strategy than working 40 years to end up wondering what retirement's supposed to look like and be one of those statistics? And if you're in the wrong side of the tracks in that 95% category, you've blown it. So here's the great news. No matter what age you are, even if you feel like you're running out of time right now, 2 years, just add 2 years to your life right now. If you're in your 70s, add 2 years. If you're in your 60s, add 2 years. It's no big deal. It's going to go by that fast anyways. Just do the right things in that moment of time, and you can figure out where you're going to be. If you don't do anything, you're a fortune teller. All you have to do is add 2 years of your life, look backwards and say what the last 2 years look like, and then look forward and say the next two are going to be the same. But if you do this, you don't ever look back. You don't ever look back if you do this. You never look backwards. You just learn from the past, so you don't make those mistakes anymore. Not say, my past equals my future. Here you go, my past does not equal my future, and I'm only looking forward. Your past does not equal your future in longevity, but if you don't do this, your past equals your future. Does that make sense? Okay, now we have to become master inviters. You must become a master inviter, and that's why I had you write down the four words so you can figure out your work track. So here's Stephen's work track. I'm Stephen now, so I'm talking to you as Stephen, and we're friends. We've been friends for a while. You know that I'm an entrepreneur. You know where I'm at in my business. You know that I'm a risk taker. You know that I'm willing to go out there and make things happen. So I come to you and I say, hey, Tracy, you know, you've been on my mind a little bit lately, and I got to share something with you as my friend. See how I'm making this conversational? It's very natural. It's flowing very easily. I'm not sitting here with sweaty palms thinking I'm making a speech right now. I'm not making a speech. We're talking as if we were talking about the Blue Jays sitting in the tree, or the waves crashing on the rocks, or the lava, you know, sitting out there that we can go find shells in. How many of you know who has a prior engagement. How many of you know who the greatest basketball player, arguably, that ever lived? His name was Michael Jordan. Everybody know who that was? Okay? Good. So if I'm standing here as Michael Jordan, and over here I'm standing as Manfred, and the topic is basketball, which of these two people would you go to a basketball camp and learn from?
Michael Jordan,
right? Okay. So if you're talking about going someplace successful in life, do you want to talk about the person who's humble, excited about life, is talking from a positive context? Or do you want to talk with the person to go through life that's telling you about their problems and their misfortunes and the things that haven't gone so well? Right? It's the same thing here. And so when I'm talking with Tracy as Stephen, and I'm approaching her saying, you know, I really appreciate your friendship, Tracy. It's been really neat all the times we've been able to spend together and talk about life and reminisce about things. And you know that over the last couple of years, I've been working hard as an entrepreneur, putting this business together. I'm so thankful. I've learned a lot of lessons. I feel privileged to have the opportunities I've had, not just in this endeavor and other endeavors I've done with my life as well. The work ethic that I've learned, the people that I've met, I've been blessed. I'm really thankful for those opportunities. And as good as all that's been, nothing compares to the newest chapter of my life that's now unfolding. That's a showstopper. It will, bam, stop people in their tracks because the thought that's going through her head right now is many things. First of all, she's thinking, wow, that's a bold statement. Because she's going, yeah, your life has been all those things. I know you, and I respect you, and I like you, and I trust you, and now you're telling me that there's like a whole other chapter that doesn't even compare to as good as what you've experienced? The question demands, what are you doing now in this newest chapter of your life? That's what she's thinking, even if she doesn't ask it. She wants to know what it is. Right? Okay. So here's how you handle that. So when she says, tell me about it, then you say, Tracy, I'll tell you what. I know you like a good movie probably as well as I do. Don't you hate it when someone tells you the punchline to a good joke? Don't you hate it when someone tells you the climax to a good movie before you even watched it? Why would you bother even watching it if somebody already tells you? You ever watched a movie trailer and you're like, why bother watching the movie? I just got the whole thing from beginning to end in 5 minutes. You ruin it. If someone says, oh, Derek, you gotta read this good book. It's amazing. You gotta read this book. The fifth chapter, you're gonna love it. They actually got they killed him and they got away with it. You're going, why do I need to read the book? So don't do that in your network marketing invite either. You guys are killing the climax before they even see what's going on. So here's what happens. Tracy, one will do. Everyone will go, oh, it's awesome. So I got this new business. You're going to love it. You're going to be great at it, better yet. You've got to meet this guy. His name is Dr. Walt. I had these neck pains and my back was killing me. And he did all these autopsies on people and eliminated these diseases. And you wouldn't believe it. People are getting well like left and right. And the commissions are unbelievable. You can make a killing over here. It's crazy. Wow. So what products are we talking about? Well, we got this Beyond Tangy Tangerine stuff. That's like the key product of the whole company. You see, you guys start telling stories. And you start telling things about people getting healed from cancer and people getting healed from diabetes and heart disease, and you're telling the movie plot without them ever having to go see the movie. So if I did that and then said, so hey, I tell you what, why don't you come meet my friend Savannah? You're going, you know what, let me think about it. Sounds really interesting, Stephen. Sounds really interesting. Let me think about it though. I'll do some research tonight. And then I'll call you tomorrow, which never happens because they did their research overnight and there's nothing to talk about now. So when we were supposed to meet or talk at 1 o'clock, you could write that off because there's no reason to get together. They formed a conclusion without having to meet, and therefore, what doesn't happen, they never saw the plan. They never saw the plan. You want a 100% show up for seeing the plan. if somebody doesn't see the plan, you can kiss them goodbye. If someone doesn't see the plan, they're never going to know what their options are. So your whole goal is to set an appointment for somebody to see the plan. What's the goal, Cliff?
For somebody to see the plan.
Set an appointment to see the plan. That's it. So wherever you are in your journey into creating wealth, into creating an established business that's concrete, that's solid, you get there by setting an appointment for someone to see the plan. And if you're not doing that, and people aren't showing up to see the plan, it's because you are showing up as an expert to the person before they see the plan. Minimalize yourself. Minimalize yourself. Don't make yourself the expert. Don't make yourself the big guy on the block or the big girl on the block. Get yourself out of the way and introduce them to a third-party higher authority. So, what I did when I first got started is I started out by being the new guy, and I didn't know anything, even though I had 22 years of experience in network marketing when I came here. I walked in this door and I said, hat in hand, I don't know anything. Teach me, show me, lead me, break me down, build me up, and exactly what happens here at this company. What's the message? What are the hot points here? What does it look like to be a good leader? I wanted to learn all that stuff. And so I just brought people in for months, and I didn't show one single plan on my own until I was an SEMD. I didn't show any plans until I was an SEMD. If you don't know what that is, I'll show you this afternoon. You need to be a senior executive marketing director as quickly as possible. Now, one reason I didn't show any plans until I was an SEMD is because we went SEMD about that fast. And some of you have been SEMD for a while, or you're still aspiring to become a senior executive marketing director. It might be 4, 5, 6 months. Maybe you're still striving. It's been a year, and you're not yet an SEMD. So you're going, when would I ever show the plan? Just get it out of the way this month. Just be done with it. And so after I became an SEMB, I started showing the plan. I showed the plan on Monday night. I showed the plan on Tuesday night. I showed the plan on a Wednesday night. And I showed the plan on a Thursday night. And I picked strategic spots around the city of Denver. And you can pick strategic spots, for example, around the city of Auckland. Find outer-lying areas, not in the middle of the city. Go out around the city and find places where the plan can get shown 4 nights a week. Every night of the week. Why every night of the week? Because some people legitimately are not able to come to the plan on a Monday. And when Monday doesn't work, you need a backup plan. So Tuesday. What works for that person might not work for the next person that says Tuesdays or Mondays don't work. So you need a Wednesday and you need a Thursday. And plus, it gets you out of the house building your business. Who shows up at these meetings? Everybody. All of you. The team needs energy. The team needs energy. So we're going to have a great role play this afternoon. I'm going to show you what happens when people walk in and they're new. Show you what the behaviors look like. I'll show you what the chemistry looks like in and around the meeting, what a meeting looks like. And I knew that if I brought my people into a meeting, magic was happening. And I needed the team as much as the team needed me. So even if you don't have a guest, you still go to the meeting. You go to the meeting every time, because pretty soon you'll get sick and tired of going to the meeting without having a guest. You're going to go to the meeting anyways, so I might as well take a guest and build my business. If you don't, you go to the meeting anyways. I'll tell you why the team needs you and you need the team. It's the same reason as if, for example, you're a churchgoer. So you walk into church, and one day, you decide, I'm not going to church this week. Statistically, the chances of you showing up the following week for church diminish. And if you stay away another week, it diminishes even greater, and pretty soon, there's like a 100% likelihood that you're not going to church the next week either. Sorry if anybody's here is not a church, but I'm just saying, you could apply that to school, you could apply that to your marriage, you could apply that to your job, you could apply it to really anything. The statistics are the same. When you disengage, it's harder to come back. That's the point I'm making. It's harder to come back. So the point is, don't ever disengage. Stay engaged. All the time. Never stop being engaged. Does that word track make sense to you, Stephen? Okay, so you talk about the fact that, hey, I've done some great things in my life. I've been blessed to have a great education. I'm a CPA. I'm an entrepreneur. Here are the things that I've done. I'm so fortunate. I've met some amazing people. I've developed some great work ethic. And nothing compares to the newest chapter that's unfolding for me now. What are you doing? And instead of doing what I said, here's what you do. You say, Tracy, that's a great question. And I'd love to answer that for you because I'm so giddy right now. I'm just blown up with all this excitement. However, I have to tone it down because I don't want to freak you out. I don't want to freak you out. And what I would rather do is introduce you to my very good friend, Savannah. Savannah is someone that's had a major impact in my life in two areas, Tracy. Two areas he's had a major impact in my life. One is my physical health, and the other one is my financial health. Tracy, I need to ask you a question. Because my assumption is, after knowing you, that those two topics are extremely important to you. On a scale of 1 to 10, how correct am I about that assumption? Totally right on? 10? Perfect. So therefore, you're going to love meeting Savannah. Here's what you're going to like about Savannah. I have so much respect for him. He is a people person. He is a leader. He's extremely successful. He owns his time. Wouldn't it be great to own your time? He owns his time. And I've never seen someone as altruistic as he is. He's constantly serving other people. And if you knew what I knew about him, you would know that everybody wants a piece of him and few people get it. There's not enough of him to go around. Because of my relationship with him, though, I'm going to make sure that you get enough piece of his time so you can fully understand what this next chapter of my life is all about. Fair enough, Tracy? Okay, so here's what I'm going to ask you next. It's Tuesday, Wednesday, or Thursday. What would be best for you if you're busy schedule? Probably Wednesday, okay? And would morning or afternoon be best for you? Morning is best for you on Wednesday? Excellent. Let's call it 10 o'clock unless you have an objection to that. Okay, great. And I'm going to make sure that I reach out to Savannah in the meantime. If anything changes, I will let you know. However, we're meeting 10 a.m. on Wednesday. You guys have Starbucks around here? At the Starbucks on the corner of such and such. Does that work for you? Okay, excellent. So I'm going to see you Wednesday at 10 a.m. on the corner of this street and that street at the Starbucks, correct? You know where it is, though. You know the parking on the back-hand side. You got to drive around the block to get in there, correct? Okay, great. I'll see you Wednesday at 10 a.m. That's how I set an appointment. Let's break that down. Didn't talk about products. I created value, right? I talked so highly about Savannah that her mouth is drooling because she's never heard anybody speak that highly about another individual before, especially as it relates to her and my relationship. And by the way, I already told her in advance what we're going to talk about. There are no surprises. I'm not hoodwinking. I'm not just throwing her against the wall to see if she sticks. I know she's not walking into something that's filled with mystere because I already told her, what does she know for sure we're going to talk about? Yep, I even asked her if that was okay. I even gauged her interest on those topics by saying on a scale of 1 to 10, how important are those two topics to you? Did I do that? Yep, so she knows what we're talking about. I know her level of interest. And I know that she is excited to meet Savannah. My job is over. I'm done. I know she's coming. You know why I know she's coming? How thorough was I about where we're meeting and when we're meeting? Thorough, right? So much so that three or four times I told her where we're meeting, what time we're meeting. I even described how she has to drive around back of the Starbucks because it's a busy city and there's hidden parking on the back side. I conclude by, once again, 10 a.m. on Wednesday. So is it likely she's going to call me up and say, oh, I got the days mixed up. Oh, I thought it was next Wednesday. Oh, I thought you said 1 o'clock, not 10 o'clock. No, I told her that I told her that I told her and reminded her what I told her. It's impossible for her to say I screwed that up. And when I say it so emphatically over and over again, naturally through the conversation and put an emphasis on Savannah, the likelihood of her calling me and canceling on me is almost zero. Because the value's there. People make decisions on value. So if something else comes up, she's going to say, you know what, I already have an appointment on Wednesday at 10 a.m. It's really important. I'm not able to change that appointment. Versus if I don't create the value for that appointment with her, something else could come along and she goes, yeah, that has a higher value to me or a higher priority. So now she's going to call me back and say, hey, Scott, you know that appointment on 10 a.m. on Wednesday that you invited me to? I'm not going to be able to make that. Something came up. That's the worst. That's the worst. You hate when people call you up and you're building your business and they say, I gotta cancel on you. So I do everything in my power, because that's the worst. Since that's the worst, I want to minimize the likelihood of the very worst thing happening to me, so I make sure that that's not likely to occur. Got it? Okay, is this helping anybody?
Yeah.
For sure? Okay. That's what we do with an entrepreneur. Now, it's almost identical no matter which other one you are. What's your name, sir?
Michael.
Michael. And what did you pick for yourself?
I'm somewhere between blue collar and white.
Okay, good. Just pick one. What do your friends mostly know you for?
Blue collar.
Blue collar? Okay. What do you do as a blue collar person?
Retail salesperson. That'd be white collar.
White collar. Retired salesperson?
Retail
sales. Okay.
You get the accent.
Yeah.
Retail.
We'll turn you into a human.
Front side retail.
Retail. Retail salesperson. So, what happens when you don't speak that accent? How do you ever fit in around here?
You're doing fine.
I just
love
you doing that.
Thank you. So, retail. You got my good friend Andrew Harley. Anybody know Andrew Harley in this room? He's from Australia. And so he says garage. You guys say garage?
Garage.
What would we say?
Who?
Oh, earth. Yeah, you guys are something. So garage. Okay, I can do that one. How do you get garage out of garage?
It's important to explain that.
How do you get garage?
The cop.
It's the
cop.
Money's the same.
The money's the same. All right, so retail sales. Yeah. And that's more white collar because you're working in a professional environment, a clean environment, using oftentimes more your voice and your technology than anything else. So that's okay though. Here's what you say. Here's your word track. Where do you work right now?
A hardware store.
In a hardware store. Okay. Okay, good. So you tell people what they already know about you. Because that's comfortable for them to hear. If you start describing something about yourself that they don't know you for, they step back going, really? Since when? And what makes you an expert on that topic? Right? And this is always a bad sign when people do this. So if you're talking to people and you see this as their body language, you're heading down the wrong path. You don't want people holding their arm. This is a protection mechanism, and it's a symbol, it's a sign that they're guarded. This means I'm guarded. And nobody in this room is doing it right now. Usually, and it's okay. Even if you were doing it right now, it's okay with me because I know I'm talking about things that are making people uncomfortable. Anytime you get uncomfortable, this is a coping mechanism. So when you can talk to people like this, and by the way, if you do this, they'll do it. If you're sitting down like John and you're crossing your legs, the whole row will do it if you start it. True story.
She's just jumping.
Two of them already started right there.
The third one's
over there.
Yeah.
So, I mean, those are things though. And it's amazing how powerful you are when you're leading and you're putting energy out there. What you do, other people will do. It's really amazing. So you say the same thing almost. Say, hey, you know what? John, you've been a great friend of mine, and you know I've been working at the hardware store for how long, Michael? You know I've been there for 15 years, and you know what? I'm so thankful for the opportunity I've had there. It's been an amazing experience. I've had amazing people coming through that door all the time. I've gotten to know some of them as my personal friends. Usually when people come in the hardware store, it brings me pleasure serving them because I know they're fixing something. It makes them feel better. I love helping people feel better. See what I'm doing? Talk about all the reasons I love what I do. That makes people go from this to this. They feel totally comfortable. If you're talking about things in your life that are working well and positive, it's a lighthearted conversation. Oftentimes we come at people like, can you believe it? This person stabbed me in the back, and the other day I had this customer that came in. I mean, I'm so sick and tired of these customers. They are driving me nuts. They always want this, they want that, and the return line is larger than the people purchasing stuff. This job is overwhelming. I wish that something, and you know what? I think I figured it out. See, if you go from complaining to all of a sudden you're desperate and you found something to rebound onto, it's like the person who was dating someone for the last 5 years. They just broke up, and a week later there was somebody else. Right? That makes you very leery. How great was that relationship for 5 years if a week later you can be with a totally different person? There has to be some kind of a cool-off period in there in order for that person to healthfully move from one relationship to another. It's the same thing here. If you're rebounding from something horrible into something else so quickly, it's a sign. So that's why you have to talk well about yourself so you're not rebounding. You got that? Is that a good tip?
Yeah.
So you got that, Michael? Got that, Michael? Yeah, because you say, it's gone extremely well. I've learned a lot there. I feel great. My boss has been supportive. And as good as all that's been for the last 15 years, I am so excited about this next chapter in my life that's unfolding as we speak. And John's going, tell me about that chapter. It's like all of a sudden you got to chapter 22 and 23 finally kicks in. You ever watched a movie where you're like, it's going to kick in any minute now? You ever had a slow start to a movie? Yeah, and it's like, wow, there it is. It kicks in. So it kicks in and John says, tell me about that next chapter. Oh, John, I could probably talk to you for the next couple of hours. I feel that excited about what's going on right now. However, I got to keep it toned down or you're going to think I'm crazy. I ask you a question, John. Physical health and financial health. How important are those topics for you?
They're both important.
They're both important? Yeah. I knew that about you. Because they're important to me, too. I knew that about you. And on a scale of 1 to 10, you're up there at 8, 9, or 10, somewhere in that area?
Yeah.
Great. Here's what I'd rather do than me spending the next hour of my life talking to you about why I'm so confident right now. I want you to meet my good friend, Savannah. Once again, when you know what I know about this guy, the impact he's had already on me in those two categories, you're going to feel so fortunate after you hear what he has to say. He has changed my life in a significant way, and I don't think I'll ever be the same. I'd love to get you in front of him in the next 24 to 48 hours. What time would work the best for you?
Anytime.
There you go. I'm done. Zip it. Change the subject. Talk about anything else. So since any time works out for you, let's go with 9 a.m. at
Downtown Coffee Shop.
Downtown Coffee Shop. Yeah, let's go 9 a.m. You know the one I'm talking about on the corner of A and B Street, right? Okay, so 9 a.m. at that Downtown Coffee Shop on the corner of A and B. Remember, there's paid parking on the street right there. I recommend 2 blocks down to the north because there's a free parking lot right there. Why don't you park there, and then you can walk down and meet me at that place on the corner of A and B Street at 9 a.m. tomorrow morning. Sound good?
Sound good.
Great, I'll see you there at 9 a.m. See? Well, that works out? Very simple. I just got the appointment. He doesn't care what it is because financial health and physical health are overwhelmingly important to him. Got it? That's how you set an appointment. Simple. Just like that. So now you have 6 people on your list, right? 6 people? Everybody got 6 people on their list? All right. If you're working with me, here's what I do. By the way, what time do you have, Savannah?
7 minutes to 12.
7 minutes to 12? Man, it's time to move. It's fast. Okay. We're almost done. We're going to break for lunch. What I do with those people, like the new people that I've just brought into the business, they just ordered a CEO pack. I make those calls with them. I tell them what I just told you, and then I say, do it. Let's get the phone numbers to go with these people. And I listen to them call the first person. And if they get in the weeds, I kick them under the table, and I'm like, I make sure they're on track. And when we're all done, I break down that first call. Because practice makes permanent.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't make perfect. Whoever said practice makes perfect is full of bullet. If you can be incorrectly practicing over and over and over again, you're going to forever do it perfectly wrong. So perfect practice makes perfectly permanent. Perfect practice makes perfectly permanent. And it can only be that way. So if you develop a bad habit right off the get-go, it's harder for me to show somebody how to unlearn it and start over again than it is for me to tweak it while they're going along, because it never becomes a habit. And then when they get it dialed in, I'm like, that's it. Do that every single time. And then several phone calls later, they're like, this is easy. Everybody I talk to says yes. And you know what? That's how I feel. I feel like everybody I talk to says yes. I don't know why. I'm being humble when I say it. It's not because I have spooky dust or magic wand. It's because I know that what I do works. And I know that I'm speaking their language when I talk to them. How could they say no? What's there to say no to? So I'm really vetting somebody out the whole time I'm talking to them. And at any time I feel like we're not on the same page, I don't invite them. I don't take the time to say, hey, I want to introduce this. I don't even go that far. I just say, well, that's interesting. I didn't realize that your health and your money wasn't that important to you, John. Well, I did have something in mind to share with you. However, in the best interest of you, I don't think it'd be a good idea if I did. And I completely take it away. I remove the whole thing from the table, and now what's he doing? Well, wait a second. What would you have said? I'm sorry, John. I don't think now's the right time for you. I was going someplace with you, but the way you responded to me, I know we would not be a good fit. He's going to go to sleep that night, wondering what in the world would Scott have said had I just, and it'll teach him a lesson. That's what happens. A lesson is learned. And he might come back to me later, and I'll say, John, you know, the only thing that's going to work out is if you take yourself seriously enough so that you want something more for yourself than I want for you. And that's the order that it has to work. I'm not allowed to want more for him than he wants it for himself. And I'll point that out and say, the only reason I didn't want to talk to you is because I know that what I want for you, good health and good finances, is not your priority. And that'd be me wanting something in those areas for you worse than you want it for yourself. So I guess I could ask you again, John. You want to change your mind?
Yes.
Are those things in fact important to you?
Yeah.
Okay, great. You're sure?
Yes.
Yeah. And so that's what I'll do. I'll come back and I'll re-qualify them. And if they're sincere, they're like, yeah, you know, you're right. I wasn't thinking. You talked to me the other day. And I'll say, okay, great. And I just start over again. And I say, here's what I want to do. I want to introduce you to so-and-so. And I set that appointment. So can everybody do that? Marion, do you think you can do that?
I think so.
You think so? Good. And you have a good person there to help you, correct? Right? Good. Anybody have any questions about that? The invite? Yes.
My question is that some of us, New Zealand's kind of small place and long and narrow, and some of us don't live within 2 hours of our, you know, upline or support person or experienced person.
Okay.
And so we'd have to kind of work on the phone or with Skype or whatever.
I do Google Hangouts. So, and I live in a small town. My town probably has 20,000 people in it. Not small?
No.
Right. All right. Well, and the number one money earner in my organization is Barb Pitcock. She lives in a town with about 5,000 people. And from that town, you'd have to drive hours to get to the next town. So,
you just answered the question. Google Hangouts.
Google Hangouts. Don't let your circumstances become an excuse for you're not able to do this.
But you always lose life. You don't just send them away.
Correct.
Yeah.
Okay,
you want to do it live because it means something. I tell them this is live. We're going to be tuning into something that's actually happening right now. It means somewhere out there in the world somebody else is sacrificing to. And then when you're done, you tell, for example, Savannah in advance, hey, I've got a whole group of people. When we're all done, could you call back into my line? I'd like to put you on speakerphone and have you say hi to a room full of 10 people. That's what I do. It works like magic. So at home, if you do have like a big screen or something, a flat screen TV, take your laptop, plug in the HDMI cord or whatever you call them here, and sync your Wi-Fi to your big screen TV, and everybody's sitting in the family room or in your living room, and they're watching something that's really happening. And you can interact, and if you know that the presenter knows that you're on there, they can make a specific shout out. Hey, I want to say hi to all the people calling in from Christchurch right now, and welcome onto this call, or on into the meeting, and so glad to have you. This is interactive, we're live right now, and if you guys have questions all the way from Christchurch at the very end, I'll pick them up on the backside. And then they feel like they're really part of what's going on. And you can all do that. It's fantastic, it's powerful, that's what we do. Does that answer your question, Robin?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Yeah. How many of you have been in a network marketing company prior to Youngevity? See, the network marketing arena is alive and well. Everybody's looking for leadership. Everybody's looking for leadership. If you're gonna go do something like climb Mount Everest, you need somebody who's done it before. You don't wanna say, hey, let's all go wing it, because the death rate is about 18% last time I checked. You climb Mount Everest, you sign a piece of paper, they make you write letters to your family in advance, because 1 in 6 chances you're not coming home at the conclusion of this expedition. So you know that you're signing your life up, and that's with all things being perfect. There's like a 1 in 6 chance you're not coming back. That's with everything being perfect. So if you don't have the right guide, if you don't have the right equipment, if you don't have the right Sherpas, those are the people that carry your stuff for you up into the base camps, etc., make your load lighter. If you don't have all that stuff working for you, it goes up from there, the percentages of travesty. Don't put yourself in those situations. Give yourself the best shot. People are looking for leaders. That's why you're always working on you. Your mindset is always something really important. People ask me all the time, what are you reading right now? Here's what I'm reading right now.
And I carry around things with me that are constantly impacting my mindset.
Here's the newest book I'm reading by John Mason. It's called An Enemy Called Average. An Enemy Called Average. Great book. This is my second time through it. And this is just powerful, powerful stuff. And I encourage all of you to read good books. You're welcome to read this one. I like it. I recommend it. If it weren't good, I'd tell you it wasn't good. If it would help you, I'm going to tell you it's going to help you. I think that'll help you with your mindset. I carry this around with me. Because the answer to that question is, yeah, I was next. I was next. Are you next? This is what goes on the front of your car. Or if that's illegal around here, you can, you know, put it in your back window something, stick it up somewhere where people can see it. What else do I carry? This was a dream of ours. I carry around this brochure right here. Actually, I narrowed it down, and we've decided on this one. This is what we call a fifth wheel. Everybody know what fifth wheels are? So you have to have a horse before you get the chariot. This is the chariot. You get the chariot, you have a horse that's just going to sit stationary. So we got a brand new Ford F-350 King Ranch diesel truck. That's the, you know, one of the big boy trucks on the block, and it is loaded leather. It is so beautiful on the inside, and when my family gets in there, it just makes me smile. And then this is a 43-foot long, they call it a toy hauler. And it sleeps 10 people. It's got 3 push-out sides. It's, the square footage on it is bigger than some people's apartments. It's got air conditioning and heating. It's got full-size refrigerator and freezer on the inside, which is big. It's like 43 cubic feet, which is enormous. It's got 2 ovens in there for baking and cooking. It's got granite countertops. It's got hang-down LED lighting. It's got awnings that go out the sides so that when you go outside, I have an outdoor television. An outdoor television with speakers built into the outside in the fifth wheel, so I can cause some trouble. I can get in trouble. And we can sit out there in the shade, feel the breeze, watch the sunset go down. The gate on the back of this thing, it's like 10 feet tall, and it comes down hydraulically, boom. And you can lower it to the ground, and in the back of this thing is a 12-foot garage. No. It's a garage. It's a 12-foot garage. And so So you can drive in, you know, cars or put snowmobiles or motorcycles or stuff in the back. You can put horses in there, two of them. And there's a bathroom, like a mud room in the very back, so when you go out and you get all dirty because you went and rode your four-wheelers or ATVs, you can go take a shower inside, or you can take a shower outside. There's an outdoor hot water propane tank out there. It's incredible. LED lighting all the way around, that gate that comes down the back, if you raise it up horizontal, then an awning comes out over that, and side rails pop up 270 degrees around, you create an outside deck. A stairwell that goes off the back, keep the, you know, the critters and stuff out. Fun. How much is this? Well, that's a good story. So, it's about $110,000 for this U.S. So for you, what, another $200,000? Okay, so $200,000 for this, and then. This whole back page is all options. That's a lot of options, wouldn't you say? So you can do without those options. So here's what I did. I called up the people. There's a waiting list to get these done. It takes months if they go build it in the factory. And so I said, this is what I want. They said, well, okay, Mr. Cardulis, what options would you like on there? And I said, I want all of them. And they said, well, do you know which? I said, yep, I've looked at all of them.